Did anyone visit Jamnagar when the refinery was under? You were working. What did you, what is the kind of feeling you got there? We got an overview. Huge.
When you stand at one end, you can see the other end. You travel kilometers after kilometers to reach the other
end. Right. And what else? It's an interesting view, you know. It's an insider view from a small. You are one part of those 3 lakh people working there.
Then you see a lot of construction activity.
Lot of construction. Everything seems chaotic.
Everything.
Yeah, but did you have any, did you have any knowledge of what was the plan for that project? How many million tons? You know, the employee at large, was that given to you? There was a shared.
Given a brief overview of what was it going to be like.
What was the time target that was set?
Yeah.
All that?
Yeah. There was a brief introduction to all the plans.
By means of a film when you first joined?
Yeah. Okay. It's a small presentation.
Okay. And?
But then.
Did you feel any excitement?
You cannot relate those plans.
You cannot relate. There was no feeling of excitement of being involved in whatever smaller way in one of the largest construction jobs in the whole world.
Because then when it is said that it's the largest grassroots level refinery, immediately you cannot relate to that largest term. But you have to actually go there and see what, how big is large.
Quite right. Quite right. But it is one of the greatest achievements in a country which has been used to time overruns, you know, and cost overruns in every project. To do it and to beat anyone in the world in doing so is fantastic achievement. And of course, the gains in terms of money, you know, to commission it on time is stupendous. That's why look at the cash profits which Reliance is making now. And gross profits of 7,000 crore, net profits of nearly 2,000 crore. It's fantastic. All right? Effective communication by articulating the vision and goals powerfully to all members of the organization. I can't overemphasize the point that any of you who is aspiring to top echelons of management, please get your communication to be powerful, both written as well as oral. It will come again and again and again and again in your career. Communicating one to one with people, communicating in groups, informally, communicating formally. You will be called upon to chair meetings, you know, even if it is a small sectional meeting. How to communicate there? How to get your point of view, how to conclude the meeting and get an outcome from which you can proceed further. Communicating within the organization and outside. If your company sends you as a representative in CII or FICCI and you are part of a committee there, how do you communicate there to advantage? So, as I said, I can't overemphasize this. This is the single most important item I think which should be on your agenda throughout your career. Here we have talked of it, inspire and evoke the trust of the organization. I think we have talked of trust as one of the very, very important, one of the foundations of credibility as a leader. Management of self. I don't think we have touched upon this earlier, but what do you think is management of self? The ability to acknowledge their own mistakes and learn from others. Is it easy? Very difficult. Do you think that this is something which people are foolish about not doing? Because don't you think that if someone comes and tells you, I'm sorry, you are right, I was wrong. What is the kind of feeling which immediately it invokes in you? That he is a good, great guy, no? I never understood him. If he can come after fighting, you know, with me and doing all sorts of things, now he comes and says, I am sorry. If it is done genuinely, if it is done with devious intent, I think we can make that out. But what else? You know, self-management, what else? Managing your health, do you think it's a self-management?
Managing your time.
Managing your time? Do you think every day that you want to do certain things, all right, which you shouldn't be doing, and you want to do, don't want to do certain things which you should be doing, and sometimes you end up winning, sometimes you end up losing. Are you with me what I am saying? You don't feel like getting up in the morning, although you should be getting up in the morning because you have work. Sometimes you don't get up. You don't feel that good about it because it's a loss. It's a personal defeat, is it not? And if you win, it gives you a good feeling because it's a personal or a private victory. Any one of you smoke here? 1, 2, 3, 4 people. This is a good sign of the times. When we were students, there would have been about 90% hands which would have gone up. At least nowadays, this generation realizes that smoking is not good for health. But some of you smokers, have you ever thought of giving up smoking? Be honest.
Yes, sir.
One. So, two or three people have thought of giving. Have you made any attempt to give it up?
Sir.
Be honest. I made 3 attempts. And fourth attempt, I succeeded.
I took up smoking in third year of engineering. I left after 1 year. Then I again took up last year in October. And I'm going to.
And did you feel good about it when you took it up,
sir,
or bad about
it? It raises your acceptability in the public when once you are not smoking.
But what does it do to you inside? Do you have a good feeling?
It doesn't do any good.
Well, it has a good feeling if you're able to win private victories, because no one else knows about it. You won the second helping of gulab jamun and you know you shouldn't be having it, and you say, no, I won't have it. It gives you a feeling of having won a private victory. And this was enunciated, you have read or heard of Stephen Covey?
Yes, sir.
Right? Have you read that book? Read it, because it talks very powerfully about management of self. Management of self. Management of self is very important for leadership. This is a new thought which is here. Ability to institutionalize the vision. That in the little 5-minute break, we were talking about that very thing, that all great leaders that you see and hear, what makes you think they're a big leader? Big leader, tell me. And we came to the conclusion is the outcome. I mean, there may be a great leader residing in him and him and me, but unless there's an outcome due to that leadership, unless we have achieved something, we cannot be acknowledged as a leader, right? Bill Gates, he has achieved something. Dhirubhai Ambani. So, and how do you achieve? By institutionalizing the vision. What it means is, a vision remains a vision which is a dream, but to translate it into reality, an implementation, that is what leadership. And create processes for continued organizational learning, continued learning. It's bad enough and difficult enough to have continued learning for ourselves, isn't it? Yes or no? We stop learning, most of us. We get so drawn up in the day-to-day activities of our job that we stop reading. And when I say reading, I don't mean reading only what you are working with, you know, not the business magazines, but doing some independent reading. How many of us has done independent reading here? Quite good. That means books which come out, you know, bestsellers in any field, in any line, in any subject which is not your own. So, we either have neither a time nor the inclination. But imagine sitting here in IIT with a wealth of knowledge right here, even if you spend 1 hour in reading, is going to be great self-management. Okay. Right. Any questions? Is anyone getting inspired to become a good leader? If not, then I am not communicating well. No one has got inspired. All right.
Sir, does a leader have to communicate regularly to all the levels of the organization, right to the lowest?
Preferably, yes.
Preferably,
yes. What Hocklassen used to do, I'll tell you. Of course, he couldn't do it every day, but he used to do it on occasions. He would come on Diwali day morning, and those days, there was L&T didn't have 30 factories and all that. It was basically Powai Works, where about 7,000 people were working. That was the main factory, which contributed to 65% of the turnover. So, come in the day, and he used to visit all the departments throughout the day. And he'll go to the department and everyone will come, all the workmen and supervisors, and he'll wish them happy Diwali. Okay? This is the day before Diwali. Diwali was a holiday. Similarly, he would come Dashera. Last day of Dashera, there used to be in each of the big departments, you know, there used to be the puja. And he would come and he would go around the shop, means always visibility. Whenever, after he retired also, even today, he is emeritus chairman of L&T, and he is on the board also. In winter, he lives here in India, and then he visits as many installations as possible. So, he will go to some, he travels to 4 or 5 cities. The basic idea is visibility. People should see. So, it is important. Now, it is not as if he is giving speeches, he is just going and shaking hands and maybe answering a few questions. People feel so nice about it. Okay. Leadership behavior. There is, as I said, lot of research which has been done on this. Potsakov drew on the modern theories of leadership styles, which we have covered, like charismatic, transformational theories, and summarized the behavior and approaches of outstanding leaders. He has done a summary. Let's see what is the outcome of his summary. He says there is a 10-point behavior model. These are the points. We have discussed practically all of them, but vision, that is articulation, congruence with the follower's value. This is important, congruence with the follower's values. If you have a grand vision of your own, but none of the people shares this, you know, in your company, as likely as not, nothing is going to come out of it. So, congruence with follower's values, passion and self-sacrifice. What's the difference between commitment and passion, Avnish?
Passion can be of a very high degree.
Very high, the order of commitment, to the exclusion of many other things. Everyone agrees?
Yes.
Okay. And self-sacrifice. Do you admire people who can do self-sacrifice, which you would not be, you would be envious of them or you would admire them, but you would not do it yourself? For instance, would you admire someone who, like Anna Hazare, after getting his MBM from here, goes and spends 3 years in a village to give the benefit of the knowledge you have gained here, management knowledge, and help the village to become a self-sustaining entity, water management, management of sanitation, energy management, gobar gas plants, cleanliness, medical. would we not admire such people? Why? They are doing a self-sacrifice. Or a doctor who passes MBBS, does a MD or a MS, but then goes to a small village area or a semi-urban setting and does practice. So, this is one of the things which has come out of the research model: passion and self-sacrifice. They go hand in hand. Passion, as you said, as Avnish said, is such a high order that it excludes many other things. You will see also people sometimes who are so passionate about a cause that they renounce family also. You know, many of the missionaries, you know, we talk of missionary zeal, isn't it? Missionary means some passion, passionate about something. They don't marry, they don't have a family, because they feel that if they do that, it will infringe or impinge on their ability to devote all their time and responsibility to their passion. Confidence, determination and persistence. This article you just showed me, what did Dhirubhai say? Someone will read it out. Just now someone showed me. Read it out. Confidence, determination and persistence. Did he not speak of something along those lines? Just read it out.
If you work with determination.
Louder, yeah, listen to this. This is a great leader who said it.
If you work with determination and with
determination. Right?
And with perfection, success will follow.
Right.
Think big, think fast, think ahead. Ideas are no one's monopoly. Don't give up courage, is my conviction.
Don't give up courage, that is persistence. Even if it doesn't turn out right first time, continue.
I keep revising my vision. Only when you dream it, you can do it.
Okay, thank you. Image building. Confident, competent, credible, trustworthy. We have talked of this, isn't that required? Role modeling, followers adopt the leader as a role model. External representation, that is spokesman for the organization. Expectations of confidence in the followers, communication of the same. What is the meaning of this? What is the meaning of this, Rohit? Expectations of confidence in the followers, communication of the same. What does he mean by that?
Followers expect the leader to be confident on that.
Followers expect leaders to have
confidence.
Quid pro quo kind of situation, is it? You trust me, I trust you. I think what Vira says is the correct meaning. What it says is, great leaders, they have great expectations of their own people. So much so that very often, even leader with a very average kind of following, you know, can inspire them to do things which people with far more talent would not be able to do. So it is an expectation. Human beings, they empathize. If I think very well of you and say you can do it, you know, then research shows that this expectation causes a reaction in the followers.
I think Ashish Narayan Zahir Khan are the example of what
we are talking about. Sarah Gandhi has just that confidence in him.
Yes.
In organization theory, we have read about something called self-fulfilling prophecy.
Absolutely.
And this is the same thing.
Absolutely, sir. Self-fulfilling prophecy. S- selective motive arousal in followers. What is the meaning of that? We discussed about motivation and inspiration. So, what did we come to? During the break, Devarsh said another thing which is very true also. He says, look at the etymology. Etymology, you understand everyone? What is the meaning? Root meaning of the word. So, what is the etymology of motivation? It comes from motive. And of inspiration? Spirit. Inspiration. So, something which you see in a flash, all right? Something which comes from within. Whereas, motivation is something which is thought out, work towards it. So, selective motive arousal in followers. If you have a dream, you want to institutionalize the dream, all right? The very act of motivating, the actions that you take, all right? You do it selectively because you want to achieve some target. You selectively motivate people. Frame alignment of leader and followers. What is the meaning of that?
Making understanding the role and
say you are the leader and your role and your goal rather is you have a project and is to build or to manufacture some products. For which there is a huge demand, your capacity is very low as compared to competitors. So, you are missing out on your market share. The quicker you bring that factory to completion, the sooner you will be able to get orders, manufacture, increase your market size. So, you as leader want very quickly to commission that factory. Now, other people who are with you, who are working on it, their motivation may be a little different. The longer, because they are on contract service, let us say, moment this job is over, they don't have a job. So, if they can stretch it out, then they have the job mode. So, what is happening? There is a divergence of alignment. So, how do you do it? If you have to do it, that is where you have to exhibit some leadership. How to align it? Because it seems to be something which is dichotomous, isn't it? Your aim and your goal doesn't seem to match with the goals of the people who are working on the project.
They finish that one particular task in a specified time, they will get that benefit out of it.
Right. So, here is one. Once you try to resolve a conceptual difficulty, you come out with many. You come out with many. Or say you are having a second project coming, all right? You can give an incentive saying that those who perform well in this project and meet the time goal, they'll get the other project and so on. I mean, lot of innovative methods can emanate from it.
Sir,
yes?
I want to come back to that selective motive arousal.
All right.
Sir,
you are being selective. Good.
Sir, does that mean that different people have got different motivation? Like, if there are 10 followers and 5 followers are motivated by money and 5 are motivated by suppose power, they want more power in the organization or things like that. So, does that mean that you are giving…
What you are saying, could that also
yeah.
be what is the meaning of this selective motive arousal? So, as a leader, you will have to use different ways to motivate people differently, each to his or her needs. Any reaction to that? Could that be the meaning? People are not clear, I think, Rohit.
Sir, those motives which are prevalent or which are widely prevalent in most of the followers, we select those and try ways and means to motivate them through properly delegating what they want or what they desire.
So it feels like very short-sighted approach.
Short-sighted. Why?
That is, you were not actually conveying to your followers what is the exact goal, but just selectively, okay, this guy can do this, this guy can do this, just as it's a very you're using them to fulfill a very selfish motive. The goal in this case will be very personal, not there.
Well, you look at it in terms of the organizational interest. After all, everyone who is working in the organization, isn't it a fair view to say if you are working here, you should work for the good of the organization? I think there can be no dispute, isn't it? And if for the good of the organization, there are some sections of people in the organization who are motivated, you know, in a different manner from other sections of people, depending on their needs or their background or the kind of work they do. Would it be wrong for the leader to select in what way he wants to motivate each of these sections? I don't think it will be wrong. It will be an act of leadership. Instead of trying to force all sections to a point of view which they resist. Okay? Inspirational communication, we have talked about that, is both. Is inspiring people and communicating that to them. It's a combination, which is really very important. Okay, are there any questions on this section? If not, we'll go on to topic of leadership skills. Topic of leadership skills has become more complex and complicated, because businesses have become very large and they have spread out geographically and they have gone into many cross cultures. So, what was good enough to provide leadership in your own country, let us say, okay, with your own kind of people, that may not be good enough if you are operating an organization which operates in Japan, Brazil, Pakistan, Nepal, Sri Lanka, and cross-cultural, maybe China. So, a lot of research has been done by Americans, because these are the companies, these giants who are spread out in many countries. And again, on leadership skills which are required in order to be successful. Yes.
Does the skills vary among the various groups?
Skills don't vary, but the way in which you approach varies. Because different cultures have different collective values also. Some cultures, right, accept, for instance, the whole concept of collectivism. That is, it is better that the group benefits instead of a single individual. It's basically the Oriental. We have more values for family and groups. Japanese predominantly have it to a very large degree, don't they? Even this whole institution of harakiri, you have heard of harakiri? It's not there now, but it used to be only 50 years ago or 60, 70 years ago. What did it mean? The essence of it was, if you feel that you let down your group, yeah, or your country, then you commit suicide. That means it was so much ingrained in their culture that you have a responsibility to your group. You cannot let down people. Even when the Second World War, you know, the instrument of surrender was being signed, you know, the head of the Japanese army, the chief of staff, right? He was on the point of committing harakiri, because that was the culture. Coming back to what you said, Therefore, that yes, culture does have, culture does have a bearing. In fact, culturally, you know, how you treat girls, you know, or women in the workplace, doesn't it depend on culture also? In small things, even today, I had been yesterday, I was in Saharanpur, where Vinod Gupta has set up this polytechnic for women, and he's also setting up this Hillary Clinton multimedia center for women. And there, you see, the women who are taking training in this polytechnic. See, one of the social problem is that having taken this training, and it's a polytechnic, so they teach tailoring, nursing, then Montessori school, running a school, painting, you know, things which can make them into entrepreneurs, and they can empower them by being financially empowered. But the biggest problem that is coming is that after they complete the course, it's 3-year course, you know, in each of these diploma course, they are not allowed to work. So they are back to the traditional, they are married, and then once they are married and they go, they are not allowed to do it. Now, this is part of our culture, all right, our village culture. In another country, it may not be so. So it has become quite important for large companies operating across many cultures to have a brand of leadership, all right, which recognizes these things. It's become critical. And research findings on this is that critical leadership skills for success in global economy. If you are going to have operations across the world, then these are some of the things that leaders in your company would have to be aware about and would have to practice, acquire and practice these skills. Cultural flexibility, cross-cultural awareness and sensitivity, what we are just talking about. You see, again, you have communication skills. You can't get away from it. You diffident communicators sitting out here, you better take notice of this and get your communicating skills in place. HRD skills, which are, you know, what we talked about, developing learning climate, training people, appraisal, that is how people are doing, give them feedback, counseling, creating organization change. Have you studied about counseling and feedback in your human resource development course? You have not studied? You have taken a course on human resource management? Two courses? Human resource management. One is behavior, the other is management. To manage human resource, that gives you a foundation. Individual behavior and group behavior. But that comes together in how to manage people in your own organization. Well, one of the most important things about people management, what do they work for? After all, they work for a money, right, for growth in the organization. So come 1st April, which is the year, which is the time most companies follow for increment and promotions, you see, and review, appraisal. That is the time, right? You have to decide, and that's the very, very difficult part, and that is where most managers fail. They are unable to counsel and give feedback constructively, unable. So whatever limited research we have here in India shows that most of the managers, they don't want to give adverse feedback. We don't suffer from that in educational institution. If you are not doing well, because it's a different milieu, But out there in the company, okay, out there in the company, it's surprising, but people would gloss over when they actually review with you and not confront you constructively about your areas where you have failed and you need to improve. So, as I say, what little research, if you have 5,000 people who have been appraised in a face-to-face meeting, all right, where you see what were the targets, how you have performed, you will find the ratings usually say it's a 5-point scale, A, B, C, D, E, will be either A or B. You won't have any other rating. It's not easy. And it can be taught on how you should counsel and what is the way of giving constructive feedback. Creativity, problem solving, innovation, self-management of learning, continuous self-development. Comes back again, we've seen this. There was research which was done by Wetton and Cameron, and they made an inventory, culling out from the research that they had done on few hundred managers. And they have listed this, verbal communication including listening. Why do they put this in bracket? Because we have all been taught that communication means listening also. Why do they say including listening? He's right, it's overlooked. We all know it, but we don't do it. And it comes out so strongly in group discussions, GDs. All of you came through a GD also, no? And when you reflect back on your GD, many of you must have taken these courses, no? How to score well in GDs. They must be having these coaching schools now. How many took courses on that coaching school? And didn't they tell you that you have to first, you should be the first of the block. You should speak first. That's the impression I got, because we had 8 sessions of group discussion, each board, and in each there were 2 or 3 people who were vying with each other to start speaking first. So, is that what we are taught?
So, they said to come up first.
There you are.
No, sir. Come up first. They said it's a high risk, high gain position. That's all.
If you come out first, you should be confident and speak properly.
That's a high
risk.
But otherwise, it's a high risk.
High risk.
Okay. Anyway, I had figured that out. And if I reflect back, none of the chaps who spoke first gained anything out of the 8 boards we had. And it's very interesting because, as I said, we all know that good communication is listening, but very few of us practice it. Again, out of these 8 boards that we had, so 8 group discussions, each had about 5 to 6 people only. There was half an hour for it. So, it was not necessary for you to be first off the block and try and interrupt. So much so that we had to tell after the first board that, remember, interruption will lose you marks. So, don't interrupt. Why is listening part of the verbal communication? Why? Anyone remembers?
So not listening and not understanding what the other part is saying. How will you react to
it? Neither can you support him or
not.
He is right, but yes, Francis.
One person says something, another person listens and understands. So even when you are listening, you are actually communicating that you are listening to that person. Unless you are doing that, it doesn't complete, because you will not know that what your point you have made is understood by me. When I show that I am listening, it's understood that the communication has happened.
When you say that it's a two-way process, listening becomes an integral part of it. But it's not stress. If you are not listening, then you are not communicating.
But I may tell you it's two-way. You are also talking, I am also talking. It's two-way.
Sir, listening assures that
you talk, I talk. You talk, I talk.
But
then it's why.
So you talk and understand, I talk and understand, then it's communication.
Yeah, listening assures that there is involvement of the participant in the discussion. Or
I can tell you can be very involved by shouting at each other.
No, sir, so it is not involvement, it is projection of self. If I am shouting, then it is projection. I am not involved in the whatever it is. There are
so have you done any role plays?
Yes, sir.
On communication?
Yes, sir.
In what? In the communication class? Oral communication?
Yes, sir.
Sales.
Sales.
Okay. But not in the oral communication?
Yes, we did.
Also.
We did. The communication is part of that.
Okay. So, managing time and stress. Just now, Professor Gautam Sinha came before this class and said, I have to rush. I have just got news. My best friend has just died of a heart attack. So, managing your stress and managing your time, very important. Now, more and more training modules are coming where they teach you yoga. You have a half day workshop on yoga within a 2 day program, and stress management by executives has become very important. Even the Westerners are accepting this. Many of these training modules come out of the West. So, what are you going to do about it? We don't have this in our course here, syllabus.
We have it outside of living. Art of living.
Art of living. But how many are you, of you are going to Art of Living?
One week course and many people have done it.
So, we have organized on this Sunday a 1 day workshop which will talk about these other things, you know, which are so important in the life of an executive apart from the rat race, if I may say so, trying to make a career. It's very, very important. So, ultimately think about it. The moment you stop functioning, you become unhealthy, you know, even you get jaundice, anything, if you are down, your whole world comes to an end basically. What are you going to do? Just lying there and being sick and out of health. And if your metabolic system fails, you know, you develop high blood pressure, diabetes in your early 40s or something, cardiac problem, then what's the use of trying to pursue a career? So, it's very, very important managing time and stress. Okay? Managing individual decisions. What does this mean? What are they trying to say? Individual decisions. In the corporate setting, organizational setting, that is avoiding a festering conflict. Is that what you mean? We have to resolve individual discussions, decisions. Take individual decisions to resolve conflict between two people?
Not necessarily.
Hmm.
I mean, even if the individual decisions are not conflicting, just to have the consensus, or at least let us agree on the decision.
Ability to take decisions and the strength to defend the decision that has been taken.
Sir,
yes.
Sir, I think it is, suppose if I have to get something, some job done, and somebody is going to do his job, he will take his decision that how I want to do it. If somebody other does some other job, he will take that in his way he is going to do. So managing all these decisions is that's what is safe. That's what I think.
Anything from this side? Avnish?
So if you're
thing to the subordinate. Let him take this.
Delegating is here.
You don't direct him that you have to do this job. You have to do this job.
I think what Polash says is what is meant here. Would you like to say it again, Polash?
Yes, the ability to take a tough decision when required and to defend it if things go wrong.
That's what you have to do as a leader. Okay? Recognizing, defining and solving problems, motivating and influencing others, delegating, setting goals, and articulating a vision, self-awareness, team building, managing conflict. Based on an interview study of more than 400 managers. This is a research finding. Huh? Who are highly effective, of course. They have selected 400 managers. And this is what they cull out of that study. Okay? Yes. Tell me.
What does that mean?
Understanding yourself. Having an honest opinion about yourself. Not fooling yourself. Deep down inside us, we generally should know what we are. Are we lazy? Are we ambitious? Do we get hurt easily? Are we looking for approbation from people all the time? Do we get depressed if we have one little adversity? Once you are aware of it, you can take actions to improve it. Self-awareness is very, very difficult. Usually, unless you have someone you really trust, you know, telling you something about you, you never come to know about it yourself. So that is the importance of having good relationships, you know, where you can take feedback. Okay? Team building, managing conflict. Another study. I am showing you all this to see how the same common things are being done, and it's coming out of studies actually. Participative and human relations. This is a classification. Competitiveness and control. Innovativeness and entrepreneurship, and maintaining order and rationality. See? So these are the basic classification of leadership skills. Supportive communication and teamwork, all right. Example, assertiveness, power and influence. Innovation and entrepreneurship is creative problem solving. Managing time and rational decision making. So, it is a combination. If you try and relate this to management styles, which we have talked about, part of it is a task oriented style and the other part is human approach style. The 10-point model of Wetter and Cameron, after further studies, they drew out what they call as basis. Skills are behavioral. They are actions that leaders take. Actions, which lead to effective results. They are not traits or styles. They are overlapping with style slightly, but they make a difference. The difference is in these two keywords, behavioral and action. Often the skills seem contradictory. Example, you have a leader who sometimes is very hard taskmaster. At other times, he is very human relations, humanistic approach, theory Y type of a style. Often seems contradictory. There are interrelations and overlaps between these skills. So, So this is the basic broad basis which is done, culled out by Wetten and Cameron out of these studies. And it leads to what we saw in a previous slide, that managers, okay, who show leadership qualities have to have versatility. That means different situations with different kind of people, they have to adopt different types of skills in order to achieve the desired outcome. Okay? And from this basis and the 10-point model, they then, the same researchers, they divide into personal skills and interpersonal skills. This is a model. Okay? Personal skills again, okay, this is overlapping, each overlaps the other. And developing self-awareness is determining values and priorities, identifying cognitive style, assessing attitudes towards change, okay, of your own. Be honest, are you comfortable with change or you are not? If your boss says, you have done excellent work here, but I see great future in you, I am transferring you to XYZ department. Would you resist that? Would you think that once I go to XYZ, it's a totally different department, I have to relearn everything. I don't know how I'll perform, what boss I'll have. With this boss I was getting on well. Will you resist that? Or you'll say, all right, I believe what the boss is saying. Maybe that's true. And maybe it's good for me to go. So let me go. Managing stress, coping with stressors, managing time. What could be a stressor? Time targets can be a stressor, right? Conflicting relationships with your subordinates can be a stressor. You have one guy within your team who wants to test you all the time. He doesn't want to work as a team chap. He's always going, that causes you stress as a leader and a manager. Delegating. One way of having the maximum stress is trying to do everything yourself in the firm erroneous belief that others can't do it as well as you. So unless you do everything, the department won't run or the company. That's a sure prescription to a cardiac problem. So learn how to delegate. Solving problems creatively, using rational approach, using creative approach, fostering innovation in others. So these are personal traits. And interpersonal is gaining power, exercising influence, empowering others. Coaching, counseling, this is for communication, motivating and listening. Identifying causes, selecting appropriate strategies and resolving confrontations, manage conflict. Right. I think if there are no more questions, we can bring this to a close. Other techniques for leadership effectiveness, personal growth training. This is a new thing which has come on the environment. You go to training programs and they ask you to go and do a bungee jump. All right. Or go white water rafting. Have you heard of all this? Why? Team building, yes. What else? Risk taking. Risk taking. How much risk are you willing to take? Say you do that bungee jump and the rope breaks, then you have to decide actually how much risk are you going to take. So in L&T, when I was heading the personnel in HRD, we built a facility in Lonavala, Management Development Center, where we have built, you know, there's a stream there and there's a little bit of a hill and so on. So adventure sports, this is used for training both psychologically as well as physically. Okay? Maybe we should take a trek or something to Kulu Manali. Huh?
Yes, let's go, sir.
Okay. Thank you very much.